Well, good morning, everybody. And can I welcome everybody to the Justice Committee's third meeting of 2017. Thank you all for coming. We have apologies from John Finney and Margaret Mitchell. The first item on the agenda is for me to invite the committee to decide whether to take items 5 and 6 in private. Item 5 is a paper on the future scrutiny of the Limitation Childhood Abuse Scotland Bill, and item 6 is in consideration of the committee's work programme. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
And can I also ask members if they're content to consider the draft report and the legislative consent memorandum on the Criminal Finances Bill in private at next week's meeting? Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed. Thank you for that. Item 2 on the agenda is a roundtable evidence session on demand-led policing, the service of first and last resort. Now, this is an informal session, and it's primarily aimed at giving us the information we need as part of our report. I think probably the best way to start is to do a wee round table so everyone can introduce themselves and we know who everybody is. So if I can start with myself, I'm Rona Mackay, MSP for Strathkelvin and Bearsden, and I'm convening today's meeting.
Sorry, there was other people in between, but of course they didn't need to introduce themselves. I'm Amy Dalrymple, I'm Head of Policy at Alzheimer's Scotland.
Filton McGregor, MSP, Coatbridge and Creyson.
Hi, David Liddell, Chief Executive of the Scottish Drugs Forum.
Good morning, everybody. Ben McPherson, Constituency MSP for Edinburgh, Northern and Leith.
Morning, Bob Leslie. I'm representing Social Work Scotland and I chair Social Work Scotland Mental Health Subgroup.
I'm Liam MacArthur, I'm the MSP for Orkney.
I'm Callum Steele, I'm the General Secretary of the Scottish Federation.
Douglas Ross, MSP, Highlands and Islands.
Oliver Mundell, MSP, Dumfriesshire.
Morning, I'm Malcolm Graham, Assistant Chief Constable with Police Scotland.
Mary Evans, I'm the MSP for Angus North and Mearns.
Morning, Peter Benny, I'm the Chair of the British Medical Association in Scotland.
Stuart Simpson, Member of the Scottish Parliament, Bamshire and Buchan Coast.
Morning, I'm Cameron Black from Bethany Christian Trust and I work with Rough Sleepers and the Care Van and the Care Shelter.
Good morning, I'm Mary Fee, MSP for West Scotland.
Thank you, everyone. Although it's informal, it would be helpful if you address, if you want to speak, if you can catch my eye or the clerk's eye, just so that it runs a bit more smoothly. I'd like to start off, if I may, by asking... Presumably, Mr. Graham, just if you could maybe outline the extent and the nature of police work, which is not primarily concerned with the prevention of detection or crime work. If you could just give us an overview of that and we can go into it further as we go along.
Okay, thanks very much. Probably for the first time in the course of the last year, we've undertaken some dedicated work as an organisation to better understand the nature of the demand that falls on policing, and it's perhaps a little bit surprising that that hadn't been done previously, either before Police Scotland existed or certainly in the early years. And what we found when we did that work over the course of last summer, and it's continuing to try and improve that picture, probably didn't surprise the vast majority of frontline police officers and staff who have seen a picture of changing demand over a number of years. I think that changing demand has resulted in some sort of key findings in that demand analysis. And I want to put a little bit of context around about that so that it's not open to misinterpretation. One of the things that we found in terms of the calls for service that are made to us was that about only one in five of the incidents that we attend results in a crime being recorded. That doesn't mean that four out of five were necessarily not crime-related incidents at the point that they came in, but when officers attended, a crime wasn't recorded. Now, to put a little bit of substance around about that, the most time-consuming incident that we deal with is still domestic abuse. So that's a combination not of just how many incidents there are, but the length of time that those frequent incidents take as well. The other thing I would say about the four out of five incidents that we attended, if we take last year, it's a real broad spectrum of needs that people are calling us for. Some of those would be instances where people perhaps thought a crime had been committed, but on attendance and inquiry, that wasn't the case. Many of those calls will be in relation to a concern for a person. This might be the substance of some of the discussion today, a concern for somebody who finds themselves in distress. It may be that the cause of that distress isn't necessarily clear at the point that somebody's phoning the police. And it may be that it's an absolutely legitimate use of police time that the first people to be called are the police, because in many of these instances, it's something that the police are always going to be responsible for responding to. So if it's somebody that's gone missing, in circumstances where people are very concerned about them, if it's a concern because somebody is causing alarm in a public place or in a private place because of some sort of mental distress, whether that's temporary through some sort of emotional distress or whether it's through some sort of recognition of a mental health issue, it's absolutely right if somebody poses a risk to the public that the police should be called. The breadth of concerns that people phone us about is enormous, about children, young people, about adults in different circumstances and points in their life, and about an increasingly elderly population. And within that sort of 80% of demand that doesn't result in a crime being recorded, there are a whole series of incidents, some of which take a large amount of time for an officer to deal with, and some of which may be dealt with in a very straightforward way, working with other people. So I could speak longer about the detail of it. I think the key point I want to get across is that it's not necessarily representative of how we spend our time in terms of the one in five, because actually when we're dealing with crimes, particularly serious crimes, the most serious crimes take the longest time to deal with, and even less serious crimes still commit a lot of officer time, both in terms of response and subsequently, and that's always going to be a primary and important role of the police.
Further question on that point, do you feel that you have the necessary resources and the skills, do you think your officers have the skills to deal with some of these issues with vulnerable people and some of the things you've referred to, do you think you...
So I think the skills that a police officer requires are constantly changing. I would say that policing has always been a profession requiring a large number of different competences. In my view, it's always been a caring and compassionate profession. And it hasn't just been about dealing with crime and criminals. Actually, whenever you deal with a crime or a criminal, you're always dealing with a victim, and that's primary in our response. I think what we have probably become more aware of in recent years and in a more sophisticated way with some of the training that we're doing now is the ability to recognise what it is that's driving anybody's behaviour if it is a mental health concern. We've done a lot of training across all of our officers and staff. In fact, over the course of the next few months, we're going to complete training over 17,000 police officers, which is all of our frontline officers, in mental health awareness. And we've done a lot of other training round about recognising the impact of trauma. We've done a lot of partnership working in terms of getting the right response for people when these things are identified. So I think the skills and the capabilities of officers is always increasing. But it may well be the case that when the police are called, the police aren't necessarily always the best organisation to meet that person's needs at that time.
Can I just open it up? Does anyone else want to come in on some of the points that Mr. Graham's been using? Callum Steele?
Thank you, Convener. I think I would like to supplement rather than contradict to some extent what Malcolm Graham has said, and principally to highlight that police demand is not just about calls for service. There are many things that the police deal with that don't originate from a call from a member of the public. You know, if we look, for example, at some of the complex criminal inquiries that we have where victims may be identified through the police as a consequence of stumbling across a piece of evidence in another inquiry, and it can take many, many months, in fact, on occasions years, to go through the work to help identify further victims, and particularly in child sexual exploitation would be an area where that would be relevant. But, you know, police also deal with incidents and events like the Commonwealth Games, demonstrations, celebrations like the Jubilee. You know, we have festivals, we deal with political unrest, weather-related emergencies. We provide policing for our road network, maybe soon even our rail network, highways and byways. We deal with the security of our infrastructure, the policing and delivery of democracy through the management of elections, royalty and VIP protection, and of course, things like the ongoing response to the terrorist threat. So it's not just a case of policing in isolation is delivered in response to service calls from the public, although that is clearly a crucial part of it. There are many more inherent complexities associated with policing than just those calls that come to the police service itself.
Thank you. Can we have Stuart Stevenson followed by Douglas Ross?
Thank you very much, convener. This can be dealt with fairly briefly, but I just want to explore what sense we have as to when the police started to take on responsibilities beyond just purely pursuing criminals. Now, I do that in the context, I have in front of me the front page of the Police Gazette from 1831. And it, for example, it has a story about a stray horse. So it's not necessarily criminality, so it's perfectly clear even then, nearly 200 years ago. And when I was a child in the 1940s and 50s, I'm substantially the oldest person in the room, the old saying was, if you want to know the time, ask a policeman. So it was clear that 60 years ago, the police were a source of information, they were a source of assistance in a very broad and general sense. And I just wonder if you've got a sense perhaps of how this sort of happened and how it's changed over a long time. Because although we are engaging with this, I think, for the first time, perhaps, now as an issue that has to be resourced and so on and so forth, it doesn't strike me as a particularly new issue in the generality, if not necessarily in the detail. And I just wonder, in particular, if Mr. Graham could say something on that.
I would agree entirely with those comments. Policing's got a long and proud history of evolution and change since the early 1800s in Scotland, setting some of the standards for policing across the world. And it's always been the case, as I said earlier, that people have expected the various organisations through which policing has been delivered, of which Police Scotland is just the latest of many, to be caring and compassionate about the service that we provide. There's a painting that hangs in the Scottish Police College, the headquarters of Police Scotland, which I think represents very clearly the modern mission for policing, but it was actually painted in the 19th century, and it's of a constable holding a small child in a snowstorm close up on his shoulder, and the child has no shoes on, and a torn-looking dress, possibly destitute, and for me sums up very nicely the mission of policing in the days that that painting was painted. If we move forward to the purpose and the mission of policing and legislation up until Police Scotland was created, which was in an Act of Parliament from 1967, the key purpose of policing was to guard, watch and patrol so as to prevent crime. And that withstood the test of many decades. But when Police Scotland was created, the mission for policing was substantially enhanced, I would argue, in the 2012 Act that came to create police and fire reform. And the purpose of policing is to improve the safety and well-being of people, places and communities of Scotland. And to me, you couldn't get a broader mission in terms of working in partnership with other services to try and improve well-being and safety, which can be defined in many different ways. And it's now through this work and through having discussions like this that we're actually starting to fulfil the promise that comes with that purpose that was laid out for us.
Would it be fair to say in 2012 that statement in the legislation was more reflective of the police's mission prior to that than actually a resetting of the mission?
I think it was a mixture of both. I would agree with that. I think that these are things that the police has always been involved in, not just, as Callum Steele says, through calls for service, but through everything that we do. But I think society in general, and policing as a part of that, has recognised what it is that drives people's behaviour in terms of mental health, for instance. And we've got a better understanding of how society has changed, whether it's through the changes in demographics, changes in the population, but also the changes in the way that people live their lives, increasingly through online means. As I see people resorting to their phones, we have a network of communities that aren't necessarily defined just by where we live, but defined by the people that we connect with, and that is a challenge for many organisations, particularly policing, in terms of both wellbeing and safety.
Thank you. Douglas Ross, followed by Mary Fee.
Thank you, Convener. Could I first of all ask a question to Mr. Graham and then perhaps a question to all of our respective guests from their particular organisations? First of all, to Mr. Graham, why did this discussion and investigation into demand-led policing not take place at the start of Police Scotland? You said yourself that would make sense to have done it then. Why didn't it at that time, and what was the trigger for doing it recently? And then perhaps I wondered if we could briefly hear from all of the other groups in here today. Basically, when I read through the evidence, everyone accepts there's a problem. Everyone accepts there could be better collaborative working. The Cabinet Secretary said that to the subcommittee. He was discussing about working together with the third sector, mental health, community services, local authorities and the health service in general. But no one has really, as I could see in their evidence, suggested here's how we could do it. We all say we have to do it. We all say this is the problem and here's where we want to get to. But there is a big gap to bridge as to how we overcome these problems. And I just wondered from each of the sectors, do you have a suggestion, if you had a magic wand, how you would achieve the better balance between the current demands on the police and how these other organisations can help relieve some of the pressure?
Okay. In relation to the timing of the work, I think it would have been good, it would have been nice if we had the capacity to do everything at once. But as you'll be acutely aware, there wasn't a huge degree of notice in terms of creating the national organisation. And we had to prioritise very carefully what we did. And the focus in the early weeks and months in standing up Police Scotland was to ensure operational competence, to maintain critical services, responding to emergencies and public need, and going through that transition period of bringing the service together, bringing the legacy organisations into one, took a period of time, and as we paused to look at what are the opportunities for the future, it became clear that we needed to better understand the evidence base on which we should shape the transformation that we can now realise from the journey that we're on. So I think it's a description of a journey rather than an event, being able to do everything at once simultaneously. In relation to the second part of the question about the general agreement that we face these challenges and that a greater degree of collaboration would be more successful in addressing some of them, I agree with that. I think there are extremely good examples, many of which I could describe, where we are working in many different ways in local areas specific to local needs, building services that meet the demands and the expectation of the people in those communities, whether it's round about elderly people who are suffering from dementia and specific pilots that we're running, where we're gathering information from families and those people that will assist if there's a likelihood of people going missing repeatedly, to the mental health triage services that we've put in place jointly with health boards. And we've had some great successes in terms of better meeting needs and directing people more appropriately to services across a large number of different local authority areas by working in partnership. I do think there's an opportunity as a national organisation for policing to take a leadership role in really substantively moving on some of these issues at a national level where that is appropriate. But I would finish by saying that a lot of the successes that we're seeing rightly are based on local need and local partnership working that best fits the circumstances in each local area.
Maybe just very briefly, just on that point, would you accept, however, despite some of these very good examples, that when it comes to a situation where someone witnesses something in their local area that they still believe is an emergency, despite what you're doing locally with dementia patients and a number of other organisations. If someone still thinks it's an emergency, they're still going to call 999 and ask for the police. So how do you get that message across that, yes, there is good work, but perhaps the police shouldn't be the first port of call?
I'm not necessarily that I agree with the notion that we should be trying to dissuade people from phoning 999 if they think it's an emergency. If people think that an emergency response is required, I would encourage them to phone 999 and allow the professionals to make an assessment about what the best response is. If it means that the police need to attend to assess what that is, and that can not necessarily be a straightforward task to work through what's actually happened, what is underlying what has happened, then that's entirely appropriate. And it may be that during the course of that exploration of events, there are decisions that can be taken that are going to lead to better outcomes for the individuals than there being a criminal justice response. It's identified that there hasn't been a crime committed, but it doesn't mean that somebody shouldn't have phoned the police. Actually, what it means is that the police can be an effective route to accessing other services on occasions that are going to better support people to try and prevent that from happening in the future.
And Dalrymple here, perhaps, because Alzheimer's was mentioned.
Yeah. Amy, sorry, not Anne.
Sorry, Amy.
You're not the first person to have done that. It's okay. Three letters. I don't hear Malcolm Graham describing it as a problem, just in response to Douglas Ross's question. And I don't think in our written evidence we described it as a problem either. It's an issue that we need to decide as a society jointly how we're going to work together to address it. And the police are a really important part of that solution. And I think they accept their role there. I don't think they're saying that they shouldn't have a role. We're delighted that we're working with the police around, I think the Herbert Protocol was what you were describing, around making sure that people have the information, you know, the police have the information about people who may well go missing. And we've been working at a national level on something that's not ready yet, about a system whereby we might have a more community-based response using social media that can support the police and other agencies in terms of you know, kind of helping out when there's an issue with people with dementia. But actually, what you can do to reduce demand is make sure that people with dementia are supported appropriately and therefore do not feel the need to leave where they are living in a way that is not known about by the people who are supporting them, whether they're living at home or whether they're living in residential care or whether they're in a healthcare facility. If they're supported appropriately wherever they are and the stress and distress is minimized and, you know, kind of the right environment is put in place, they are they're enabled to walk if that's how they wish to do that. I mean, none of us would want to be locked up in, you know, kind of however nice a facility if we wanted to get outside. And so, you know, people with dementia who want to go outside will try to do that. If they're prevented from doing so, that might create an incident. But if people are supported appropriately, and those that situation's in place, the right environment's in place, the right activities are in place, the right supports are in place for them to live their lives in the way that they want to, then we may end up reducing these incidents. We also see, and the discussion that I'm hearing today around people with dementia and is calling the police inappropriate, I also hear this discussion quite a lot around calling paramedics and calling an ambulance and people being admitted to hospital. And preventing these inappropriate hospital admissions is very similar to preventing these incidents where people are missing and the police need to be involved as well. But we're working really, really well with the police. Many of Malcolm Graham's colleagues in Police Scotland are, as many of the members of this committee are now, I think, looking around the table, Dementia Friends, and taking part in the Dementia Friends Scotland role. That's the kind of beginning of it, the beginning of a dementia awareness, but we're looking forward to working further with the police in terms of being able to support them, work with them, and bring together the other agencies. You know, kind of social work's really important, and, you know, kind of residential care facilities, to make sure that people are properly supported the people with dementia deserve the same protection as everybody else, is the fundamental of it. And we've got to make sure that we as a society are working together to make sure they get it.
Mr. Benny, can I ask you to come in and just the second point of Mr. Ross's question about integration?
Yep, will do. I suppose the first thing to say, just to put it in personal context for me, I chair the BMA in Scotland, but I also work clinically as a consultant psychiatrist in Paisley, so this is day-to-day bread and butter for me. I was talking with police just yesterday when they brought someone across from A&E in circumstances that were maybe not quite as good as they would normally be. We had a very strong response from our council members when we put this question to them from across many different specialties. And I think the headline before we go any further is to say that the general experience of doctors in these kind of situations is that the police are doing a very good job in difficult circumstances. And I'd very much echo the sentiments that have been spoken about already, that what we're talking about here is a key police role. There's no other agency that is able to deal with someone who is in distress in public than the police, and they have legal powers to do so if that appears to be a mental illness. In terms of how we should be taking things forward, I think it's simplistic, but you can divide these incidents into two. Incidents that occur with people who are already known to have vulnerability, often as a result of a mental health problem, whether that's dementia or a diagnosed mental illness, and incidents that arise with someone who's not known to the services at all. Where someone's known to services, it is essential that there's pre-planning, because we know that people with mental health difficulties are going to present in emergency situations. We should be able to predict what those emergencies will be, and at least to some extent, have a care plan that outlines the way that we would want to deal with that. Now, I have to say, from my experience, you simply cannot write a care plan that covers every possible eventuality. And if you try to, it will fail. But you can and should think about what's likely to happen with a person and work out who is available to respond to that, both during normal working hours and out of hours. The second group who present with no history at all, you obviously can't predict what's going to happen at an individual level, but we know that people will present in a crisis, whether that's as a result of intoxication or acute mental illness. You know that that's going to happen, and what's crucial there is that there are very good links between the police, who will be the first point of contact in many circumstances there, and quite right too, but there need to be good links with well-resourced local facilities, including out of our general practice, psychiatric services, social work services, and emergency departments. Now, I heard the magic wand language. The other language that's often used around this is money trees. The bottom line is that we are, all of us, every agency around this table, working in very, very tight financial situation. So that does mean we've got a responsibility to do the best we can with the available resources, but it also means we've got a responsibility to say that it does require more resourcing to do this job well.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to come in on Mr. Ross's question? Callum Steele.
Yeah, thanks, convener. I think the question as to the how or the what is one that is much more inherently complex and complicated than the one-word question in its own right might suggest. I mean, clearly, how you deal with the demand for the purposes of this session on the police service doesn't just sit with all of the agencies around this table. Demand comes in a whole variety of different areas, and I don't think I've heard any dissent so far, but you know, the solution to that is not going to come from a single point. It's got to be a complete community-based assessment, a holistic view as to how we deal with the individuals that might need help and assistance in whichever guise that might manifest itself, whether it's medical, whether it's care, whether it's policing or whatever it is. But I think there's a couple of fundamental things that have to be recognised in all of this. And whilst we are dealing with particularly challenging financial environments, I think it would be really remiss of me to say, or to not say, that austerity is a choice. You know, it is not a necessity. And the imposed austerity that are being visited upon all of the services and third sector organisations in this room and others makes it very difficult for us all to deliver services and protect the vulnerable people in our community. When we look at the cuts that are being visited upon all agencies in the public sector, and when we look at the knock-on effect that that has for third sector organisations, we then cannot sort of kind of sit in a very middle-class way and have cups of tea and chatter about how we might make things better. We have to make sure that the resources are available to make real differences and changes to people's lives. And whilst we all talk about partnerships and collaborations, we also have to ensure that we have the capability and the capacity to make sure that these are more than 9-to-5 partnerships, or if I'm being kind, more than 8-to-8 partnerships. Because when crisis occurs, by the very nature of the word, it tends to be unpredictable. You know, care plans or whatever that might be aside, the likelihood of those that were involved in the drawing up of the care plans being responsible for their execution at the point someone comes to police attention is pretty slim indeed. And ultimately, you know, we are going to need a phenomenal amount of resource to make sure that all of the services have the capability and capacity to do that, all that we need.
Thank you. Supplementary from Mary Evans.
Thank you. It was really to follow on from Douglas Ross's question, because I want to thank Amy for clarifying some of the issues there, because I think from reading some of the evidence, and I think it was some of the comments initially from Superintendent Crossan, I think it wasn't entirely clear that, you know, what was being looked for and whether it was a case of, right, are we trying to move the police away from being the first responders and we need to see if there's another way of dealing with people who have mental health issues, in which case I had exactly the same questions as Douglas Ross, really, and just that, you know, if it is a case of that, how do people become aware? Because obviously it's not always apparent what issues or what mental health issues somebody might be going through if you're presented with a situation where they are in crisis. So it's been interesting to hear all of your takes on that and some of the suggestions that you've had around that too. I suppose it is, I mean, I know Douglas talked about, you know, if you had a magic wand, but it was just really to tease that out a bit more and to see, well, to what extent, I believe, Malcolm, you talked about some pilot schemes that were ongoing just now, that either any of the agencies here today are involved with projects that are looking at how we can better operate with things, and really if you had any suggestions for the committee on how we can progress this work. And that's a wider question I have for the committee members here too, is how will we be taken this forward? Is it a case of us working with the health committee as well to try and progress these issues? Because I think it's really important that the issues that we discuss here today aren't just left to the meeting today, but we do progress with them and move them on.
I think that's a good point. I think that's something we'll definitely bear in mind after today's discussion. Further supplementary from Stuart Stevenson.
I just wanted to follow up on Callum Steele's quite proper 8-to-8 reference. And I just wondered if there was academic or other research that actually gives us a profile of across the schedule where the demand and the different demand. I think we all, and I'll put it in quotes, know, for example, that alcohol-related demands increase at the weekends, although I haven't seen academic research that tells me that. And of course, we also know there are other people who are the first point of contact besides the police. The one that sprang to my mind that isn't in the room, for example, would be the Samaritans, where it might be that the police or others will get psychiatric support, might get involved. So I just wondered if there'd been any research that might help us to plan better, all of us, not just the police, but all who might end up supporting. Because I do remember when I was at university, there was research done on, and this was before induced births, when are children born? Because the myth was they were always born overnight, and it turned out the academic research confirmed that the peak birth time was 3 a.m. in the morning. So I just wonder in this context if there is actually some good underpinning research that might help us all do better planning. I don't know who might have the answer, if anybody.
Malcolm Graham.
This is part of the work that we're going to develop over time about better understanding demands on policing and where they come from. And as Callum quite rightly said, that isn't just about calls for service, but it is a large portion of our work. And you're right that a lot of calls for service that are unplanned do come to policing out of hours and over the weekend. I mean, there's two reasons for that. One is that the nature of some of that demand happens during those times disproportionately. So, for instance, I think nearly 50% of the missing people that we are called to look for are reported on a Saturday or Sunday. Was one of the figures that arose out of that, which was very interesting. The other reason that could underlie some of that data that we don't have any certainty about is that perhaps people phone the police out with hours or at the weekends when they might otherwise have access to other services. And we're starting to look at that in a little bit more detail to see why it might be that calls, for instance, about people who are mentally distressed in a public place might increase out with hours and at the weekends, and how that relates to the availability of services. But we don't have any sound data around about that. Just one anecdote, if I could, to finish on, and I don't have evidence around this, but it is a consistent theme when I'm speaking to officers and staff who deal with these calls specific to children and young people. And an anecdote that was relayed to me over the course of the last couple of weeks in relation to a call where officers went to deal with what was reported as being a domestic abuse incident. And it turned out, actually, that it wasn't, but that it was some people who had children, a couple who had a history of mental health issues that were well understood, and there had been some planning for. And it was actually relatively straightforward at that time to access support for the adults. But the children, who were also identified as potentially needing some mental health assessment and care, couldn't access that support at that time, and indeed went into a different system. And that felt to the officers that were dealing with it as if that wasn't necessarily the best service for that family at that time. Now, it isn't evidence, it's an anecdote, but I think it's a powerful anecdote, which I would hear repeated to me on many occasions, which I think would be a useful area in terms of exploring the availability of services specific to children and young people.
Thank you for that. A final supplementary on this from Oliver, before we move on.
Yeah, it was really following on from Stuart Stevenson's supplementary, because I just wondered, going back to the 4 out of 5 figure, because I know you're saying there isn't a lot of data there, is whether there was any breakdown on those incidents in terms of how often the police are called out to non-crime incidents outside of office hours, and whether that would help the committee at all in understanding that. And again, whether there was any regional or geographical variance within them, because one of the things that concerns me is this sort of, there is lots of good partnership working going on with the police, but I look at my own constituency, you know, with a large rural area where actually services aren't right next door to each other, or you know, the police really are the only organisation that has that geographical sort of spread in terms of where it's based. So if there was any further way of breaking down those numbers to give us a bit more of an insight.
So there is a breakdown in terms of all of the calls for service. The way that we did the demand analysis work, we broke it down using 4 criteria, which broadly is analogous with Callum Steele's earlier point. We looked at public and incident demand, which is really people contacting the police, or in many occasions another organisation contacting the police on behalf of somebody, whether a statutory service or a third sector organisation. Protective demand, which is more our sort of proactive capability. Preventative demand, where again we will be working with others to prevent things from happening before there's a call. And then the pre-planned activity, which covers all the events and various calls for police to be present for a pre-planned purpose. There is a breakdown at a national level in relation to the calls for service that come in through the sort of call centre route. We're still working on that in terms of trying to break it down into local areas. There is a breakdown round about what those different call types are, but some of them are quite large baskets. Things like call for assistance, which covers all sorts of different things that people would call us for, makes up quite a large proportion of those. Concern for an individual, which covers all sorts of different concerns that people would have, some of which would be very serious. I'm concerned that somebody's died and they're in their house, to I've been watching an elderly person who's my neighbour, and I'm a bit worried that they're not getting on so well. I've just seen them going into their house. And then all the other sort of crime types that would be within that as well, which are more clearly categorised. So that is work in progress.
Thank you. Mary Fee, followed by Mary Evans.
Thank you, Convener. And Mr Graham, I wonder if I could perhaps start with you, just on the aspect of planning. We know that the Policing 2026 strategy has been developed, and I wonder if you could give us any update on when that is liable to be completed, and also how you will take forward this specific piece of work in relation to the 2026 strategy to ensure that you have the capacity to properly care for the people that you come into contact with.
Thank you. So the development of a 10-year strategy for policing has been in progress, and actually the work to underpin our understanding of where we're at now in terms of demands was what started that work off during the course of last summer and autumn. Over the course of the late autumn and through the Christmas and New Year period, we've been developing what we would like to present as a public consultation, as a start to a conversation about what the long-term future of policing looks like. Because whilst the police have a view and we have a better understanding of what the demands on the service currently are, we strongly feel that the shape of the services that people receive needs to be based on being able to listen to what people say. So that public consultation is still planned for later in this financial year. And we would like to use that then to develop the next three-year policing plan. And that needs to coincide with the investment that we will need to make that happen. And therefore, we're timing the development of the public consultation with our understanding of the budget planning process for next year.
Do you have a more specific date? When you say later in the year, do you mean in the spring, the financial year?
Yes.
Or do you mean the financial year, so
yes.
It will be before the end of March?
Yes.
That's fine, thank
that's
you.
That's our plan.
That's very helpful. And how the other question I wonder if you could perhaps come back to is how you will ensure that you have the capacity to deal with the incidents that we're talking about today. Because there is no one-size-fits-all. So while you can plan a strategy, how will you ensure that you always have the capacity to deal with vulnerable people within that? And who will you work with?
So that is a key plank of the strategy. Working in collaboration, in partnership, focusing on the different communities that we serve, that's going to form the basis of the public consultation and the conversation longer term that we would like to have with people. I go back first of all to a point that Callum Steele made about austerity, which I don't necessarily want to get into, but what I would say is that we would be needing to do this anyway. Whether we were feeling more or less financially constrained, it would be the right thing to do, to be working in partnership, to provide better services with people. And we will always need to make choices about how we prioritise the limited resource that we have. And our view has long been that the best way of providing services for people is to work in partnership, collaborating to work around the outcomes that we're seeking to improve in people's lives, and to make sure that they are shared, particularly as people feel financially constrained. So how will the police make sure that we are making best use of the resource that we have, I guess, is the question that I would seek to answer. One way that we're approaching that is a piece of work to redefine the way in which we prioritise our response based on the threat and the risk and the harm that we think will be caused to people. And if I go back a number of years, it might be that we had a less sophisticated approach, that we would have responded to what we thought a person's needs might be based on the way in which the call came to us. So if somebody reported a crime, if it was a minor theft, for instance, we might respond to that based on a sort of blanket approach of it being a minor theft. The approach that we're seeking to develop through training of staff at the point that calls come in and through a different way of triaging the priority of that response is based on the individual threat and risk and harm that comes to that individual. And an example might be that if I was to be subject of a minor theft when I go back to my car after this session, and I report it to the police because I'm looking to make an insurance claim, it might not have a particularly significant impact on my life. I'm able to deal with that, and I'm able to navigate my way through the police and the insurance company. If, however, I'm an 80-year-old man who's suffering from dementia and I don't have terribly many people around about me to support me, and I'm subject of the same theft or a minor theft in different circumstances, the response that the police need to put in might need to be very different. It might need to be faster. It might need to be in with people attending in person. It might result in a range of different links into services and outcomes for that individual. So that's an example of the approach that we're seeking to develop over the course of this year and next that hopefully answers the question about prioritisation of resource.
I wonder if I could just ask you a further question. You mentioned in an earlier answer about the training that you were going to give to 17,000 officers. Can you explain a bit more about who is doing that training? Is it in-house training? Are you working in collaboration with outside agencies, and how will that be developed?
So it's a training programme that's based on our early experiences of the mental health community triage systems that we've set up in most areas of Scotland now, and that's all been done in conjunction with local health boards and NHS areas and some other third sector organisations who've supported that. The training is being delivered in-house. But it's based on a team of people in Police Scotland who've led that work with NHS professionals, and it's about raising awareness of what the issues are, the appropriate responses, and making sure that people are aware of the various different choices that there are in terms of accessing services for people.
Okay, that's very helpful. And my final question relates to homeless people. We've kind of focused a bit this morning on people with dementia and mental health problems, but of course people that are homeless can be homeless for a number of reasons. They could have mental health problems, could have drug and alcohol problems, there could be other problems that they're homeless. And I just wonder, perhaps Mr. Black, you would be a good person to start with. How do you think the services that homeless people get, how good are they? Is there some changes you would like to see?
Good question. We work with the police a lot. We have a shelter here in Edinburgh and services across Scotland. And the police will bring individuals to the shelter very, very often. And most nights they'll be in attendance for some reason. Open 28 weeks this year. And we're very happy to work with the police, and the police are very good at dealing with individuals for whatever reason that they might be homeless, be that mental health or relationship breakdown through drug and alcohol problems or rent arrears or other reasons relating to foreign nationals as well. We are a catch-all net in the shelter, so we look at anybody who wouldn't have anywhere else to stay that night, who'd otherwise be sleeping on the street, can come to us. So we're often brought people by the police because they know that we're open. sometimes there's a difficulty there because they're sometimes we're brought the wrong types of individuals, or we're also over recent years, last couple of years, we've actually been very full. So there's a crisis in rough sleeping we would see on the streets. Couple of years ago, three seasons ago, for example, police brought us 96 individuals of the 763 that stayed in the care shelter for the 24 weeks that it was open then. But the last couple of years, we've not been able to take as many individuals because the police are bringing them later on when we're already full, that we would see very happy to work with the police in this, but actually the problem is not necessarily to do with policing in that instance, but there's a broad spectrum of things that are going on there, including the fact that actually there's not available housing for people who even are eligible to be housed by the councils under statutory duties, temporary accommodation, and further move on. Social housing is full, and we're seeing these things backlog up to us.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Before I move on to Lee.
Yes, thanks. I mean, it really comes in on the back of what Cameron was saying, and trying to, I suppose, understand potentially how police demand could be reduced. And I think this vulnerable population that Cameron is talking about, I think it's useful for us to define that in a bit more detail. Certainly, our focus obviously is people with drug problems, of which there are 61,500. But within that, you have a huge crossover of people with drugs and alcohol problems, mental health issues, offending, homelessness. So this is a group that, by and large, are known to services, as Peter was saying in terms of this group. They're not hard to reach, but they're hard to engage with in various ways. And I think that as a group is a group that we need to, and certainly we've reflected on this a lot in terms of things like drug-related overdose deaths and other things, actually, that this population is the most vulnerable. They drop in and out of services, in and out of prison. If they're on a prescribing program, they tend to be on it for a short period of time and then drop out. So all of these issues of, you know, inappropriate, I suppose, or care that doesn't stick by people over the long term, other things that need to be addressed, so that actually, that if you like, the police are not picking up on these casualties, which is actually an issue for the services. And certainly that in terms of answer to Douglas Ross's question about specific solutions to that, I suppose is that certainly one of the things that we've been looking at is in England that they've got one or two approaches called Making Every Adult Matter, which is actually looking at most vulnerable populations and having much more intensive long-term care for those individuals, so they're not just left to drop in and out of services on a regular basis. And I mean, just maybe add to that in terms of people with drug problems in particular, which I say form quite a significant part of this most vulnerable population, is that what we're seeing is an ageing population with increased vulnerability. So, for example, of that 61,500, over half are over 35, and that will continue to increase in terms of some of the projections that we've looked at. So this will become an increasing problem, and it's not only all of those issues I've mentioned, but also a range of healthcare issues that they've got in terms of multiple morbidity that are not being met as well. So I think the issues, and I think it's been said by my colleague Amy from Alzheimer's Scotland, I think is a lot of the issues are to do with actually improving the range of other services, you know, alongside the police work, but actually, and as Cameron says, is the problem of actually just being able to do that. So I would urge that, and for example, you've got particular models there, things like Housing First, to pick up on your point around homelessness, which has actually looked to provide housing to people ahead of actually them resolving their drug or alcohol problems, because basically otherwise it's a catch-22 that people actually can't stabilise their drug and alcohol use because they're homeless, but they can't get a house until they do that. Thanks.
Thank you, that's useful. And just following on from that, this is a good time, I think, to bring in Bob Leslie. Given that we know that one in four people have mental health problems, can I just ask how you feel, you know, people are being supported in the current system, and if you think it's adequate?
I think I would echo my colleague's plea that, and as Dr. Benny refers to, the money tree, it's not the magic solution. We know we're working in constrained times and we'd all love to have more resources, but we have to be realistic and work with what we have and try and tailor our services as best we can to address the needs. I work in the same area as Dr. Benny in Paisley, and the vast majority of our demand coming through the social work services, and this is where the demand through the police service comes in, as we get the adult protection or adult welfare concern reports coming in every day. And to date in Renfrewshire, we've had over 2,000 since April concern reports come into social work. That's quite a vast number that have to be screened, looked at, and then followed up. Some of them may be criminal matters that have been reported, sexual offences, domestic violence, and there will be a parallel investigation going on. Others will be individuals who are in various crises, whether that's mental health, addiction, or other issues. One of the strategies that locally our Adult Protection Committee have been trying to adopt is we have a community safety hub that meets daily, which is with all council departments, led by our public protection team. And Police Scotland are represented, Scottish Fire and Rescue and the Local Authority Warden Service and the Housing Department. So there's various concerns come in through there and can get screened and individuals signposted and also cases picked up and directed. We also within the social work team have a, what we call a repeat referral group, and that's picking up the multiple referrals which Dr. Benny will see through our mental health system, and also the police will see coming through our their call centres. We have a number of individuals in the area who, shall we say, have got the season ticket for contacting either Police Scotland, NHS 24, rolling up at A&E, phoning Social Work Standby, whatever agency it happens to be, they'll be well known and pop up every so often with a crisis, in fact very regularly, sometimes multiple times in a day. And the purpose of that group is to try and look at how we can tailor support. And often, as Mr. Little has indicated, some of these individuals are incredibly difficult to engage with because of their personality or because of the state of their addiction and the point in their journey that they're on. And that makes delivering services very difficult. The demand, as has been evidence around the table, is just rising all the time, and the resources on the ground to actually be able to deal with the demand just isn't there. We've reconfigured our mental health hospitals. We've taken inpatient beds away, supposedly to put resources into the community, but the community resources don't match the demand, and that's the reality we face.
Right, thank you. Stuart Stevenson, supplementary.
It's a tiny bit of clarity, and it may be I just missed what was being said by Bob there. At the 2,000 referrals, was that the whole of Scotland or just your area? Just your area. Could I be clear what area that is then?
That's Renfrewshire Council.
That's Renfrewshire Council, right. And just the time scale is that? Over what time is that, 2,000?
1st of April 2017 to present.
2016,
sorry.
Yeah, and I'll just equally say MSPs at the surgeries have what we term frequent flyers, so it's everybody. Thank you, that's helpful.
Thank you. Can we have Liam MacArthur followed by Oliver Mundell?
Just picking up on Mr. Leslie's point about the presentation of individuals who, whether it's a drug addiction or an alcohol addiction, are very difficult to then engage with to diagnose. I mean, we've heard, I think, anecdotal evidence of police officers presenting initially to deal with a call, finding an individual in distress, clearly under the influence of drugs or alcohol or potentially both, taking that individual to A&E, for example, nobody being able to deal with the individual until the effect of the drugs or the alcohol is worn off sufficiently for a diagnosis to be made, and then to then be left with a choice of either taking them back to their home or putting them in a cell. And very often it's the latter, which I think police officers have made abundantly clear doesn't to them appear to be an appropriate place to hold that individual, but in the absence of any other options, that's really the option they opt for. I mean, I know there's not a magic wand that can be waved on all of this, but in relation to that specific issue, are the things that we can be looking to press, whether it's health boards, whether it's community mental health teams or whatever, to try and ensure that what we're not seeing is individuals with probably mental health issues, but addiction issues as well, finding themselves in the cells in a way that only exacerbates the problem that was initially presenting itself.
Dr. Benny, yeah.
Yeah, do you want me to have a go at that? I mean, speaking in general terms, one of the issues that we have is that going back 20, 30 years ago, many of those individuals would be admitted to hospital for a short period of time. I worked at the Western Infirmary 30 years ago, and there was a so-called short stay admission unit, and it was almost exclusively for exactly that situation. And the reason for it is that it is
effectively impossible to do a proper assessment of somebody's mental health when they're intoxicated. And you can sometimes run into real difficulties of failing to diagnose underlying either medical or psychiatric conditions because someone is intoxicated, and the classic scenario there is a head injury, a subdural hematoma, which develops gradually and can mimic intoxication. And so having somewhere safe to observe a person who is sobering up from drugs or alcohol is very useful, and we don't really have that resource anymore. And so, as you say, that situation is dealt with in different ways in different parts of the country, but rarely dealt with all that well. There's also the far more recent phenomenon of the so-called novel psychoactive substances, sometimes known as legal highs. And at its most simple, the real difficulty that we face with them is we can't be sure whether someone has taken such a thing. Testing their urine is not feasible, not possible. You can't actually detect whether someone's taken one of these substances or not. And the period of time that it takes a person to recover from that initial period of delirium is often much, much longer than the few hours that you would usually see with alcohol or drugs, sometimes several weeks or even longer. And of course, those people do end up in hospital, usually in general hospitals, and are very, very difficult to manage there, often requiring police assistance as well because they can be extremely violent.
Is there, in a sense, what you've described there is a situation where in the past there would be bed space available set aside for those sorts of incidents, which simply has been removed from the system generally, but where the demand, if anything, appears to have increased, or it's just become more pronounced because there isn't that bed space available?
I don't think we can say with any safety that the demand has increased in terms of numbers, but the nature of that demand is changing as well, particularly with the different and more longer-term presentation with the novel psychoactive substances.
So as part of the partnership working that Mr. Graham was talking about earlier, has there been discussion in particular localities or nationwide that reviewing the disappearance of that bed space is something that needs to be looked at again?
I'd refer that one to two places to my right.
Yeah, so I'm happy to answer that first. I'm not aware that there have been specific discussions about sort of police role in influencing sort of bed spaces in the NHS and whether that's appropriate or not. I mean, there have been a number of instances where local authorities have provided facilities for people to detoxify. I'm not sure if that's the right phrase, sober up. And indeed, there's a legislative enablement for local authorities to do that. They're few and far between. I agree with your general point that police cells are not necessarily the best or the right place for people to be in these circumstances, but you know, they are a safe place as a last resort, and that is why on the occasions that you describe, and it is again an anecdote that I would hear frequently, and the data would back it up, that often after the police attempting to find a variety of different ways of dealing with what might be the best care and support for an individual who hasn't committed a crime, were forced to bring them into custody for their own safety, which is not ideal for that individually, first and foremost, but is also resource intensive in the organisation because these people need to be monitored in police custody at times, you know, the whole time that they're in custody. I think the wider point, and it goes back to the question about where could the committee perhaps focus some attention in terms of moving this on, I think there's two points I would want to make. The one is that what we mustn't do, and whether it's a challenge or an opportunity in the austere times that we live, is a matter of perspective, I think. I see it as an opportunity, that what we mustn't do is shrink into the silos of the organisations that our services have generally been designed around. And actually the best examples of where we design services that best meet people's needs are where people are able to step out of that, where leaders are able to look at the system and they're able to look at it from the perspective of the needs of the individuals that are coming into it, identify where those needs are not being met, and design new ways of delivering services. That might be actually people who would normally be employed by health boards might be employed by the police service working in a control room to make that early assessment. Or there might be people who are employed by a health service and by the police service in a car together going and responding and able to provide a service to people that they need at the time. What we can't have is that the service that people get is dependent on who somebody chooses to phone, because people might phone an ambulance, they might phone a doctor's surgery, they might phone the police, or they might phone another organisation during or out with hours, and the service that they get shouldn't necessarily be dependent on that choice. I think the broadest issue for me at that system level is then that we mustn't conceive of the systems as being in silos. So it's not about the health system, it's not about the justice system. And one of the areas that I would really like to see strengthened relationships and prioritisation of work is the interface between public health, which is the origin of most of the underlying factors that cause people to come into the justice system, and the justice system and policing being at the heart and normally the gateway into that. And a strengthening of the relationships and the joint working between public health and justice, I think we'd start to see a shift towards trying to identify ways in which we can prevent that demand coming to the police door and do it in a way that's going to be consistent with actually the aspirations of public health across the country as well, which is about keeping people well as opposed to curing them from being ill, I guess. And there's an analogy in the justice system that we could draw.
Thank you. Callum Steele.
Thank you, Convener. I think just in some part to build on the evidence just given by the BMA, and that is about what we used to have compared to with what we do have. And I draw on my own experience as having policed in the Highlands and Islands. And there was a fantastic facility located on the elbow, if you like, in between the hospital and police headquarters in Inverness called Beechwood House. That was a third sector organisation. It was run by the Church of Scotland and provided facilities to help people with drug and alcohol abuse for both short stay and long term assistance. Relied heavily on funding from a whole variety of different organisations, including the police. As luck bad in this case would have it, when all these agencies started to withdraw their funding, the facilities closed and put the responsibilities back, ultimately, largely on the police tender being the service that was caring for them. Now, what that did was that removed from people in crisis the opportunity to have access to people that A, understood their addiction, B, understood their psychological needs, and C, understood the harm or risk of harm that was open to them whilst they were in that vulnerable position, and moved them almost exclusively into the criminal justice system, where, as a consequence of no progressive change in policy, they would invariably end up not being prosecuted. But of course, ultimately, if a procurator fiscal gets 30 or 40 reports of a drunken and incapable person, at some point in time, they will take action and then move the problem into prison. So, you know, any notion or suggestion that finance has got nothing to do with this, I think is deeply, deeply unhelpful. Yes, of course, it's always going to be important that we collaborate and work and we mustn't retreat into silos, but we cannot pretend that money is not an issue in all of this, because it absolutely is. It's the big giant elephant standing in the middle of this room just now that no one seems to be prepared to be having a real conversation about. And that is always going to be frustrating. And I think it's particularly important to make that point in reference to the question, the very specific question that Mary Fee asked, and I think it was a fair question, that was, how can the police always guarantee to have the capacity to deal with the people in crisis? And we can't. No service around the table can always guarantee to have the capacity. We get it wrong, mercifully and frequently, but we do get it wrong, and on occasions, people fall through the gaps. What we have to get to, though, is we have to get to a stage where we don't have political hand-wringing when these mistakes occur, as is often the case. And we have the benefit of hindsight saying, you should have done this, you should have done that, you should have done the next thing. without a genuine recognition of the phenomenal workloads that people in health, people in education, people in social work, people in prisons, people in criminal justice social work, and indeed police officers themselves are carrying. And we are carrying the risks of many, many vulnerable people in our society on a day-to-day basis, and we are doing the very best we can, I think, as was very helpfully pointed out by many people, under very, very difficult circumstances. And the lack of finance invariably leads to a pressure on the people and invariably impacts on the support services that we have in our own infrastructure. I mean, the police service, if we had nothing other to do than deal with the people and ignore our buildings, ignore our equipment, ignore our IT, ignore our communications, we could probably get on with all of that. But there's a reality about what we have to do to maintain and deliver our service in the background. And the need to continue doing the things that hold your service up from a technological and facilities perspective invariably comes at the cost of those that end up delivering the service in the first place. And when you have fewer people dealing with more crisis and more instances of crisis, that in itself is going to lead to a breaking point, and it will lead to many vulnerable people being failed by the system, the mythical system that people talk about that's been put in place to serve them.
Thank you. Supplementary from Stuart Stevenson, and then we'll move on to Ben McPherson and Fulton McGregor.
I just say I have a couple of family members who are nurses at Craig Dunane, so I know a little bit about the area that Callum Steele has been referring to. I just wonder, and he may not be able to answer this, but my question implies an answer, whether Beechwood actually was probably a more cost-effective way of dealing with a particular category of client than they're being dealt with by the police, which is a comparatively expensive intervention. And indeed, that might be true elsewhere. So in fact, the Beechwoods of this world might be a way of not only delivering better outcomes, but making better use of the money. Is that a fair comment, or is that far too simple-minded to be sustainable?
Sometimes simple things are the right things for that very purpose, is because they don't need much more analysis than the fact that everyone understands conceptually that they're the right thing to do. But Beechwood House did more than take pressure off the police service. It took pressure principally off the accident and emergency department and largely short-stay admission units in Raigmore Hospital. And I have to say, also from Dr. Gray's, because it extended often into Murrayshire, which will be known, I suspect, by Mr. Ross. And whilst Beechwood was of its time, I believe facilities similar to Beechwood, which would have the capability to deal with individuals' health needs, whilst having the self-evident security, if you like, and authority that is brought by police presence, are very, very important, but I think it needs to go much more beyond that. And indeed, highlighting, weren't we very clever, Scottish Police Federation in our own right suggested that we need to come up with bespoke arrangements, facilities, to deal with people that may be disposed to violence as a consequence of either mental health or addiction or some other kind of vulnerability, which does not necessarily mean that they would be best dealt with by being preceded through the criminal justice system. Again, I think the written BMA submission helpfully identified that the law hasn't changed in terms of criminal behaviour. Policy decisions in respect of prosecutions have. So whilst we still have crimes in the absolute sense and of their definition, the police largely, not always, but largely try to avoid putting people through the criminal justice system, if we can at all avoid it, because we know that there is a very strong leaning now towards avoiding prosecution and ending up putting people into courts. So if we're able to come up with facilities across our great country that involved police, involved social workers, involved those with addiction specialisms, involved those with health specialisms, then I believe we could make some significant steps to at least dealing with one small part of the area of demand that comes upon our service.
Would be more effective and might, and I only say might, be cheaper. Thank you.
David Little.
Just touching on Beechwood and other services like, for example, the Glasgow Drug Crisis Centre, I think those sort of short-term respite facilities are needed across the country for this vulnerable population that we've talked about. If I can just go back to Callum Steele's point about austerity, and I think you know, obviously we would echo that, particularly the funding cut that's taken place for alcohol and drug partnerships last year and likely to be sustained this year. That I think the challenge with that and other cuts is the always being on the back foot of what we want to achieve in terms of being proactive. And I think you know, an example of that, talking of the vulnerable population, say, you know, particularly in Glasgow, is the outbreak of HIV among drug injectors, which, you know, you could trace back to the challenge of you know, resources and actually services not engaging well with that population. So I think, and interestingly, that now is a driver for looking at safer injecting facilities and heroin-assisted treatment. Now that is a response to a crisis, and actually we don't, you know, we don't want to be in that position that actually we're on the back foot responding to crises and creating new services, if you like, after the event. I think, and going back to my original point about this vulnerable population, I think we do need to specifically look about how we provide long-term care, whether that's a, you know, a care worker, but somebody who takes an interest in those individuals over the long term, because that's the refrain continually from users that we speak to, and you know, right the way through the system, is that nobody takes an interest in them over the long term. There's a short-term interest in their needs, and then they drop out of the services and nobody follows them up. So I think that group, we could make a significant impact, and actually it would save resources elsewhere in the system, not just actually police resources, but long-term costs to the health service and more widely.
Thank you. There's been a lot of supplementaries on that, so I'm going to move on, but we can come back to at the end to anything that still needs to be asked. Ben McPherson, followed by Fulton.
Thank you, Convener. It relates to what Mr. Liddell's just said and also what Mr. Steele said about austerity. My question is focused on the vulnerable population that you described, but I'd like to just start off with an anecdotal example. In late last year, a constituent came to me at my surgery, having been reassessed for employment support and allowance, and spoke about suicidal tendencies that they were having, and I reported it to the police immediately, and officers locally dealt with this situation superbly and provided lots of support. And I think that's a good example of where the police are responsive in areas that are that we've been discussing today around the vulnerable population. But what it also makes me query, and I'd be really interested to hear comment around the room, not just from Police Scotland, how much, if I accept that some of the statements may also be anecdotal around the table, but I'd be interested to hear comment and thought on what impact you believe UK government welfare reform has maybe had in terms of creating extra pressure on this vulnerable population group.
Who would like to come in on that? David Little?
No, it absolutely has, in terms of the population that we deal with, particularly in terms of, you know, people's ability to move towards more stable drug use and long-term recovery. You know, particularly in relation to sanctions and just the problem that people have of even volunteering and just being the way that they're treated within that, in terms of actually potentially being pushed towards employment, which in many cases those opportunities don't exist for people with a 20-year history of a drug problem. So I think undoubtedly sanctions have impacted adversely on the population that we deal with directly.
Thank you. Any other witnesses have a view? Yes, Dr. Benny.
Yeah, it's very clear that austerity has had a double hit on the health services and the health of the population, in addition to the much tighter finances since 2010. You've also got the hit on individuals who are placed into poverty by the changes in the benefits entitlements. And I certainly see, working as a psychiatrist, some of the really quite bizarre decisions about who is supposedly fit for work when patently they're not.
Thank you. Amy, would you like to come in on that at all?
I mean, it's a more general point than the one that Ben McPherson asked about welfare reform, just about the
that agrees with everybody else, so I wasn't going to really, but it is just that you see, when you see other services around social care, around social work, around health being stripped back and them not being able to work together to provide what people need, what you end, this is the bump in the blanket, if you like, or the carpet, or whatever you want, you know, your mental images. This is where it's coming out, is you end up with demand on further demand on police. And it's not necessarily saving anyone much money.
So there's a perception that it has impacted on demand. Is there anything Police Scotland can add to that as well, or I appreciate that? It may not be the data.
Yeah, I don't, neither through sort of anecdote or data that we have, I'd be able to say with any degree of certainty. I mean, what we do know is that the demands on policing are changing. We don't know to what extent and why. We don't really understand underlying reasons behind why some of those demands change. And as I said right at the start, we don't have a great baseline of data going back over many years. Perhaps because of the nature of how we have reorganised as various functions. So I'm not perhaps best placed to answer that question. I do think a lot of the discussion that we've had perhaps over the last 10 or 15 minutes in the committee has focused very heavily on symptoms. I don't necessarily know exactly what they are symptoms of, but I would go back to the point that our proposal, the key proposition coming out of our longer term strategic approach that we discussed earlier will be that we make an emphatic shift in partnership with others into preventative services. And actually that is ultimately the best way of reducing demand in a way that's genuinely removing that demand from services. And I would go back to a point that I made earlier about children and young people. I know they're not specifically represented by a group that works exclusively with children and young people around this table. But I do think it's a very important point in terms of demand, that there's a disproportionate amount of demand comes to the police about children and young people who are in crisis, often because of their parents, many of the symptoms of which we have heard talked about. But the children can sometimes be lost in that. And I gave one anecdote earlier, and I think that it's incumbent on us as leaders in those systems to make sure that is highlighted and prioritised, not because in any sense children and young people are the future of the country or because they're going to build where we go tomorrow, but actually they're the here and now. They're the people who demand that attention, who are vulnerable by dint of their very age alone. And I think if we're going to develop services in any area, then that should be a priority and a focus for the future.
Thank you. Callum Steele then, Bob.
Oh, sorry.
Just in response to Ben McPherson's question, I think from what we would term a traditional crime police demand, I think there is a very pronounced danger in assuming that those that are poor are more likely to commit crime, because I don't think there's any evidence that would support that. In fact, I think actually quite the contrary, that they have a very strong sense of self-worth. But there is, I believe, a particular vulnerability that is associated with those that are in poverty and extreme poverty, and that is the opportunity for them to be exploited and the opportunity for them to try and seek some kind of solace in activities that would not necessarily be legal. So their vulnerability to payday loans, their vulnerability to those that peddle drugs and alcohol, and the self-evident cycle of despair that can create could result in demand coming through the police service in that way, rather than just as a consequence of the welfare reforms having a direct impact on the criminal behaviour of individuals.
Thank you.
Just for clarity, I was more alluding to the range of services around the room and the added pressure on that. I wasn't making any directed statement around an increased capacity for crime amongst any section of society.
I'd be
interested to hear what Cameron Black maybe had to say on in terms of...
I think Bob and then Cameron.
Yeah, I'd just like to echo. I think we are seeing the effects of the welfare cuts and the austerity programme that has brought that about. We're seeing, certainly in social work services across Scotland, an increased demand, an increased presentation of people destitute. And we've seen the growth of food banks across the whole of the country and in our towns and cities. And, you know, there's not a day goes by in our office that there's a number of people who present destitute, looking for food bank referrals, vouchers to go to the food bank, where even in our office we have an emergency stock of very basic essentials that doesn't mimic what food banks give, but we give people at least a starter, and also give them vouchers, people with no utility credit for either gas or electric, because they've been sanctioned by the DWP or haven't got their claim processed. It's in the system and we can't get the logjam, and an increase in referrals in work by our benefits advice team that help people through that maze of what is now the welfare system, and through the appeals process that can take quite a long time, as I'm sure many of the elected members around the table will know. So yes, I think we are seeing the knock-on effects, not just through social work, but through housing and homeless services as well.
Thank you. Cameron, would you like to comment?
Yeah, certainly. We, as I said earlier, are sort of catch-all, so we see people coming to us for all sorts of reasons when they're down on their luck and have come to the end of themselves. And anecdotally, certainly people will speak about sanctions on their benefits and welfare reforms being a direct result as to why they've ended up on the street. However, it's difficult to say that there's actually not an increase from every single area of reason, really, locally and nationally. And budgets being tightened in all places, as Amy was saying. Someone used the phrase, a meeting I was at, where they said people are no longer falling through the gaps, they're being hammered through the gaps. So we are seeing an increase as a result of that, but from lots of reasons as well. Yeah, and then the police are catching this as well.
Thank you. I'm conscious of time. We have a couple of supplementaries which I propose to take after Fulton MacGregor.
Yeah, thanks, convener. And I would follow up from Ben McPherson's point there and saying that I had the pleasure of, or it wasn't a pleasure actually, of viewing the film I, Daniel Blake, recently. And I think, Ben, you were at that screening as well. And I would encourage MD, who hasn't seen it, to view that. And what was really striking about that particular film was there was three or four instances where two law-abiding citizens, at the start of the film, were propelled into contact directly with the justice system, and that seemed to be through the film itself. It seemed to be because of the impact of the benefit and welfare sanctions that they were facing. That was just a supplementary convener. One of my main points was actually to bring Bob Leslie and David Liddell in about something that we've discussed a wee bit already about the first point of contact. And I think we heard what Malcolm Graham thought could be done, about particularly around weekend contact. And I think that actually, in my experience working in social work for 12 years, that a lot of the times actually during the week, the weekdays, the police aren't actually the first point of contact. When a person's known, they've got maybe a social worker, they've got maybe a drug and alcohol worker, they've got various people involved. But then things can radically change at the weekend, and it's not uncommon for social work staff or whatever to be coming in a Monday morning, and things have maybe transpired over the weekend. And I suppose what I'm asking is, what do Bob and David think could be done to tighten things up over the weekend so that the police have got the support that they need when they're making an assessment of an individual who may be particularly vulnerable? Because they could be involved in quite a serious incident. And if the police are going to have to deal with that, they have to deal with that as they see fit at that time. But it might not be dealt with that on a Monday or Tuesday, if that makes sense. So it's a very broad brush question. But just because the police had already given a sort of answer to that, I wanted to give you guys an opportunity a bit more.
Yes, David.
I think that's a really important question in terms of, I mean, the challenge for services, obviously, is that they're mostly open. Certainly drug and alcohol services are mostly open 9 to 5 during the week. So I think, a wider, range of opening times and support workers. We've had some of that in terms of arrest referral programs and other schemes which actually have worked outside of that. But I think definitely that there's a need to explore that. The challenge, obviously, is how we're actually services contracting, how we're going to actually expand and actually deliver that. But I think it would make a huge difference, and certainly in terms of work we've done around the older population of people with drug problems. We did a recent survey of 129 individuals, of which 79%, average age 41, 79% were living alone, isolated with significant mental health problems among a range of other problems. And what you see also with the drug-related deaths, that obviously in those periods, particularly around Christmas and New Year, you've got added problems where the services aren't around for individuals. So I think it's definitely an area that should be explored alongside, as I said, that wider issue of, you know, of trying to, I mean, it's probably the same issue, I guess, in terms of making long-term regular contact with the most vulnerable populations.
Thank you. Anyone else like to come in on Fulton's point?
Just to say, we have a similar experience actually with our dementia helpline. That's open 24/7, 366 this year, last year, days a year. And we find that it's at night and over the weekends, but particularly at night time, that we see an increase in calls, because people just don't know who else to phone. Otherwise, they'll phone the county. You know, they'll phone the social work department. This is often carers, a family carer, a spouse, sometimes a son or daughter, and at night time, it's just well, who else am I going to phone about an incident like this?
That's good.
Would I be able to ask Leslie? And can I just clarify for the purposes of asking Bob to speak as a social worker, I'm not criticising social work anyway. I'm exploring an issue that I think's always been around in people, well, for certainly in all my years working in social work, it has always been an issue about the weekend and how maybe services can be tied up over the weekend. So I just wanted to clarify that point.
Yeah, I think it's a difficult one, as you rightly say, Fulton. Out of our social work services kick in normally, end of the working day, back at 5 o'clock. Most local authorities have an arrangement where they've got an out of hour service, and it varies across all the 32 different local authorities. In the west of Scotland, well, certainly greater Glasgow area, most of the local authorities around Glasgow buy into the Glasgow and Partners out of hours social work service based in Glasgow. But a number of authorities around the central belt, the Lanarkshires, the Ayrshires, Dumfries and Galloway and the Borders have their own arrangements. And it is difficult to provide, and the BMA briefing paper does indicate that helpfully the out-of-hours responses are more limited because the number of staff on is much lower. The staff don't know the local individuals in our area unless they're alerted to it. And again, part of that comes down to good, robust communication and interface with our IT systems. I get frustrated coming in, and I'm sure Fulton's experienced this in his career. You come in on a Monday morning to a range of alerts from the out-of-hours service, and at the bottom it will say unable to access that particular local authority's record system. So therefore, the standby staff have been working blind, that they have not been able to see the notes that maybe have been put on as an alert to our out-of-hours colleagues. NHS 24 have a similar issue. It's only the information they have to look at, as I understand their system, is that GPs can put notes, special notes on the health system that pop up when the call handler or the nurse dealing with the call can refer to. It's only as good as that information is there. So whilst we might fire information in, if that system breaks down or the connection breaks down to standby, they might not be having that full impact of, you know, here's what to do if so-and-so phones you, because we were alert to the fact that there might be a crisis over the weekend. But the ability of standby to actually respond and the access to other services out of hours is limited because majority of services, you know, go into shutdown mode out of hours over holiday periods, and that is a difficulty and that's a challenge, I think, for all services, whether it's social services, health services, or even the voluntary sector, everybody goes on to lower manning. The costs of running a 24/7 service is just unsustainable.
Thank you. Yes.
More point, this thing for Malcolm Green, is that okay?
Of course.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. It was actually talking about the missing person protocol, and I've seen that the sort of areas that, or the individuals, if you like, who the focus is on, and that, and I would completely agree with that. But I wanted to ask about people who don't fall into any of those three categories. You know, I know that there's a sort of 72-hour wait. That's maybe not the right phrase, but how are people who don't fall into those categories treated when they become missing persons?
So I think the purpose of the categorisation was recognising that a huge proportion of the calls that we get for people who've gone missing fit into those three categories, and we wanted to develop specific work that was going to try and address some of the reasons why those people go missing. So one of the categories is looked after children. Now, to follow on from the point that has just been made about out of our social work, whether children are looked after in residential or whether they're looked after in some other way, there's a whole variety of reasons why looked after children repeatedly go missing, and the police are not necessarily at the heart of reducing the reasons why that would be, but we're normally on the receiving end of the call when that person goes missing, and it's often hugely time-consuming and intensive to ensure that that young person's safe. So it wasn't really intended to try and triage the response in each individual instance. It was more about making sure that we were putting in place the best response, recognising that there are kind of broadly different needs. For people who don't fit into those categories, they don't get any kind of lesser response. It's not triaged at a level below those categories. It just means that there isn't something bespoke that we've developed that's recognised the specific needs of, for instance, a child or a young person, or perhaps an older person suffering from dementia. Does that answer the question?
It does, thanks very much. There was recently there was quite a high profile case in my constituency of a missing person, and the family of that, and unfortunately had a tragic end when the young man was found. The family of that young person have been in contact with myself, and one of the things that they're now raising is that the first 72 hours they felt were quite crucial, and they didn't feel that maybe enough was done at that point, because obviously the police were waiting, to see if the person was missing. I have to say that the family have been extremely complimentary about the police in Coatbridge, Louise Brown Lane. That's been well publicised in the press and whatnot, and I wonder if you would be open to meeting with my constituent and myself as well to discuss his concerns around that. That would be.
So I'm not aware of the specific circumstances of the case, and I'm very sorry to hear that it had a tragic outcome for the family. I haven't been involved in that personally, but I'd be very happy to take off the table any details and make sure that an appropriate senior person that has got knowledge of the case is able to meet with the family and discuss it personally with them. That absolutely won't be an issue.
Thank you. Douglas Ross, followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Convener. Could I go back a little bit to Liam MacArthur's questions, and it's to look at it from a different angle. We're speaking about demand-led policing and obviously the amount of resources available for the police to go out and do their bread and butter work. And if the police get tied up with other functions. And really my question was about the NHS involvement in custody centres, because I understand in some parts, if not all parts of Scotland, the police pay the NHS to come into custody centres to deal with some issues that arise within the custody suite. But certainly in some parts of Murray, I've been told that although that money is paid to the NHS don't come into the custody centre, and therefore you have two officers taking someone who's been detained, and they set up for a large part of their shift in A&E with a patient who could possibly be seen within the custody centre. So I was just wondering if Callum Steele or Mr Graham or anyone else else had experience of that, and how, again, it goes back to what you're saying about acting in silos. This is something that I think is very positive, but if it's not working well on the ground, it's actually a waste of money, and we're taking resources, again, off the street to sit in A&E when they could be better used out in our communities.
Mr. Graham?
Yeah. It's a really good point, and the first thing I would say is that there's a high proportion of people that come into custody who are accused or suspected of committing a crime that actually fall into the vulnerability criteria that we've broadly been discussing. They have mental health issues, they may have a diagnosed mental health illness, they have substance abuse, and like so many of the people that we deal with, actually all of these things overlap in somebody's life at the point that's sometimes led to them coming into custody in the first place. In relation to medical care for people in custody, the police don't pay the NHS to provide that. The police used to pay under legacy force arrangements on a number of different arrangements for either private healthcare to come into custody or for NHS boards, sometimes singly or sometimes in groups, to provide healthcare in custody. But at the start of Police Scotland, we worked with the government and with NHS Scotland, and there was a sum of money transferred from the block policing grant to the NHS, and they were then obliged to provide the service for not just healthcare and custody, and something similar had happened previously in Scottish prisons that you might be aware of, but also to provide the service for forensic medical examinations of both victims and of accused people. And as we went through that, we developed standards of service that could be expected. And it would be safe to say that at times it has taken longer than the police would like for those standards of service to be met in some areas. Now, I think it's relatively straightforward to do that in large custody centres. So if I take Edinburgh as an example, where I was previously the commander, you have a large custody centre at St Leonard's. You have nurses who, out of hours, are employed there full-time, who work there, who have access to medical information for who are essentially patients. They can link that up with other healthcare needs, either what's happened before or what might need to happen afterwards when somebody goes back into the community. For whether it's their substance abuse, mental illness, or some other healthcare need whilst they're in custody, and that's a good model. It is self-evident from the journey that we've been on, it is much harder to provide that level of service in smaller custody centres, and generally they are in more remote areas. So it's something that we are actively working with the NHS on, and we're working with the government to ensure that those standards improve. And it's not just about healthcare for people who are in custody, it's also about the forensic examination, which has been an issue over time as well.
Thank you. Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to pick up on, again, something Callum Steele said, I thought I heard him say, that statistics of criminality and poverty are not correlated. Was that a statement related to the national position? Because I think there is some substantial evidence that the areas of multiple deprivation, there are a much higher proportion, in particular, of victims in those areas, although also probably, and I'm not so certain about this, also a higher proportion of offenders in our area. Was the reference to actually the national figures, where I think it's less clear, as we've seen declining crime rates, while poverty in certain respects has been going the other way, that there is a correlation, that there appears to be a difference between these two things. Is that fair?
It is fair, and indeed work undertaken by the Violence Reduction Unit in Scotland identifies that those exposed to poverty are much more likely to be victims of crime than perpetrators of crime. I think it's probably quite important to expand on this point slightly when it comes to young, vulnerable people, because those that find themselves in poverty, they still tend to have the same wants and desires as their peers who maybe have the better clothes, or certainly the designer clothes and the fancier gadgets. And there is a greater likelihood
that they could themselves be targeted from those seeking to exploit them, taking advantage of those desires, particularly in the area of sexual exploitation, where the victims of crime may not see themselves as victims because they are getting, by their way of it, rewarded in some way by being able to either have a new phone or some new clothes, which makes it very difficult for the police to get involved in, because they don't see themselves as victims of crime. So that's I think, a fair observation.
That's a helpful expansion of the previous remark. Thank you.
Thank you. We're just about out of time, but before we close the session, I hope I'm not putting you in the spot here, I'd like each of the witnesses just to give a very brief, possibly one sentence, key message from today's session that you'd like to leave with the committee. If you can do that, anybody who's got one can pitch in first, that's fine. Just what you would like to get across to us from today's session, what your message would be. Callum.
We're not going to make any substantial difference to the lives of the majority if we don't stop looking at them as a financial consideration and start treating them like a human consideration.
Thank you. Anyone else? Dr. Benny.
Joint working on this is essential, and I'd very much echo we're dealing with individual people, and we have to be thinking in terms every time of what's best for that individual person. But let's also remember that our backs are against the wall financially because of the austerity agenda.
Thank you. David Liddell.
I mean, Malcolm talked about the silo working, and I think, you know, picking up the point about the vulnerable population, you know, and the crossover, I think, you know, that's something we do need to look at. I mean, I very briefly give an example of the people with dual diagnosis that are often pushed from mental health services to addiction services and back again. So there's a need for those services and a range of others, homelessness and offending services, you know, all to work more effectively together to help that particular population. Thanks.
Malcolm Graham.
Let's focus on the cause of these issues rather than exclusively the symptoms. We need to turn around the emphasis of where our resource is focused, and let's make sure that we're directing it where it's likely to have the greatest effect. And as I'm sure members of the committee know, you're most likely to improve and substantial impact on people's life chances before they reach the age of five.
Cameron?
Yeah, I think it's probably just to echo that the solutions for this are upstream often in lots of different areas.
Thank you, Anne. Amy. I keep calling you Anne. Sorry. It's all right. Again, just if you put in place the appropriate supports to enable people to live their lives, to maintain independence, you're going to reduce this demand. And also, you know, we take very much a human rights-based approach to working with people who have dementia. And I'm delighted to see the nods around the room. I think that thinking of it in those terms really helps direct us towards the kind of solutions that are going to work and are going to respect people. Bob.
So much of what's been said, I think, yes, we need to have very effective joint working and an examination of how we better coordinate all our services as agencies. But I think in the wider context, I warm to the idea that perhaps your colleagues in the Health and Sport Committee maybe need to also partner in some of the work, because it's cross-legislative and cross-issue, and also perhaps a wider debate across society in general about what they want our services to look like, both police, NHS, social services, as I do think that's beginning to get lost, and a lot of focus is on here's a problem, how do we fix it? And I think in these times where we're put back against the wall with money, we need to sort of go back to basics and say, right, what do we want and how do we want it delivered, and how much have we got to do it with?
Thank you. Well, it remains for me to say thank you very, very much to all of you, all our witnesses today. I think it's been an incredibly useful session. We have got so much out of it, and we will be discussing ways in which we can take forward everything that you've said today. It's been quite an invaluable discussion that we've had. So thank you very much. I'll briefly suspend to let the witnesses leave, and we'll have a bit of a comfort break. reconvene the meeting. Item three on the agenda is consideration of four public petitions. And if I could refer members to paper three, which sets out the options available to the committee when considering petitions. Just to remind you, if you want to keep a petition open, you should indicate how they would like the committee to do to take it forward, or if they wish to close, if you, anyone wishes to close, set out your reasons for wanting to do that. I propose we consider the petitions in the order they are set out in paper three. That's petition 1501 and petition 1567, which is investigating unascertained deaths, suicides and fatal accidents. Can I seek members' views on these petitions? Stuart Stevenson.
One of the things in relation to this was in relation to the tornado collision, which we've got correspondence as a committee on, where the story that's brought to us would suggest that the opportunity for the system to look at what happened there may have, because of cross-jurisdictional responsibility as a military, the home base of the person who died in Scotland being in England, there appears reasonably laid out that opportunities may have dropped through the system. And I think I would be interested to hear from the Scottish Government, in particular, how they deal with issues around military related deaths, because of course the military is ultra vires for us as a parliament, but I understand that it is vires for us to make inquiries, and I'd just be interested to know what protocols exist there, because I think that might lead us to an understanding on behalf of the petitioner as to whether what has happened is what the best available outcome. Clearly, it doesn't bring the loss to a different position of the individual who died in that accident. But I would want to know that before considering that we should close the petition.
Thank you. Can I just point out that it's a third party you're referring to who brought to attention the military. It's not the petitioner, it's the third party.
To the petitioner. I do stand corrected, convener, but my point nonetheless stands.
I take that point, yes. Well, I agree with that. Any other views from members? Douglas Ross?
I fully support what Stuart Stevens has said. Mr. Jones is a constituent who's been in contact with me about this. I have written to Annabel Ewing about it because I think some of his wider concerns come within her remit, but I think it would be useful for the committee, while keeping open this petition, to go down that route. I also have another constituent who has raised issues in Parliament about mortuary services within Moray, but her husband tragically died in a sudden death. It was a boating accident, and she had concerns over guidance given by the Crown Office to police about destroying personal items. And because this petition looks at the wider sudden death issues in Scotland, I wondered if we could write to the Crown Office for clarification on those issues.
I'd be happy to do that. I don't know what others think. That sounds reasonable. It's connected. Yeah, it's a good suggestion. Another suggestion, I had wondered whether we should write to the Lord Advocate to get his view in relation to the military question that Stuart Stevenson raised on, you know, how he would deal with it. The incident that was referred to was with a previous Lord Advocate, so it'd be quite good to know the current Lord Advocate's views. If members think that's a sensible idea.
I mean, I would certainly agree with that and the points that Douglas and Stuart have made. I mean, as the papers indicate, Mr. Jones has also expressed specific concerns about the communications from COFS, and I think actually that can be wrapped up in whatever we're going to say to the Lord Advocate in that letter. Yeah.
Ben and Fulton, any views?
I'm quite happy with what's been said already, what's been suggested.
In agreement with the...
So happy to proceed on that basis?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. We move on then to the next two petitions, which is petition 1510 and petition 1511. and it's with respect to police and fire control rooms. The petitions are discussed on pages 3 and 4 of the paper. There's also a letter from Tavish Scott MSP included in the submission, so I wonder if we could seek views on that. Stuart.
Again, I think these are matters where we're not yet in a position to close these petitions. The reorganisation of service centres in general, I think there are concerns have been raised. We're now in a position where we're able to see whether these concerns are justified. I'm sure those who are running the services concerned are very alert to these concerns. I wouldn't want to close these petitions until we can actually see that the reorganisation of service centres has delivered the improvements in service which are possible through that and the other benefits that have been claimed for them. So until we can see that, and I think it really is up to the police and fire services to report on their experience and then be challenged on what they say. And at that point, it's for us to perhaps then consider whether it's the time to close these petitions.
Thank you, Liam.
Again, I'd wholeheartedly agree with what Stuart said. I think in relation to some specific incidents that have arisen and that were highlighted by a former member of the fire service in relation to incidents in and around, I think, Inverness, it would be useful to get Alistair Hayes' view on that. As I understand it, I think Tavish Scott's actually met with Alistair Hayes since writing to the committee. I think for the purposes of the committee, in the context of the petitions that sit before us, it would be helpful to get in writing from Mr. Hay his perspective on those incidents.
All right. Okay. Thank you. Any other views? I'm happy with what's been proposed so far with both Stuart and Liam's. I think that's the best way to proceed. Mm-hmm. Any other opinions?
No, I would agree with the points that have been raised.
No, all agreed to go forward in that way. Thank you. So we move on to agenda item 4, which is the Justice Subcommittee on Policing. And we invite feedback from the convener of the Justice Subcommittee on Policing to give us some feedback.
Okay.
Mary Fee, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. The Justice Subcommittee on Policing met on the 12th of January 2017 to discuss its forward work programme. And can I refer members to Annex A of Paper 6, which gives details of the issues that the subcommittee is to consider over the next few months. And you'll see that the subcommittee is to take evidence on the Stop and Search Code of Practice on the 26th of January, that's this coming Thursday. And members of this committee are more than welcome to attend that meeting or any future meetings of the subcommittee. The Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee is taking evidence from the Auditor General on the morning of Thursday, the 26th of January, on our 2015-2016 audit of the SPA. And again, members are more than welcome to attend that meeting. Could you please let the clerks to this committee know if you do intend to attend it? I believe the subcommittee now has quite a busy schedule of work until well into the spring. And if members have any suggestions of areas of work for the subcommittee to include in a future work programme, please let me know and I'm happy to answer any questions committee members may have on the work programme.
Any questions for the convener of the Justice Subcommittee in general or on the work programme? Liam.
I think just reinforcing the convener's point about Thursday's evidence session, it's not often that we get an opportunity to hear oral evidence on something that's going to come before the committee in the way that these stop and search provisions will. So I think if colleagues have time available, it may be worth coming along to that.
Yeah. It will be. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mary.
We now move into private session. The next committee meeting will be on the 31st of January, when our main item of business will be private consideration of a draft report on the Criminal Finances LCM. Can I suspend briefly to allow the gallery to clear?